Hey, everybody. Before we start our podcast today, we just want to give a special shout out to the Evil Pudding Podcast. They are Courtney and Patrick. They are also in the true crime genre, and they have, they're kind of newbies just like us.
I love our newbies.
Yeah, we love
our newbie friends.
Yeah, we love meeting people all over Instagram, and we want to give them a special shout out, and they have an intro they want to play for you guys.
Check them out, please.
Yeah, please do. So without further ado, here they are in their intro.
Hi, I'm Courtney.
And I'm Patrick.
And this is our true crime podcast.
Evil Pudding.
We are a husband and wife duo.
I'm ex-military and law enforcement.
And I'm a true crime professional fanatic.
And we will together will cover the most depraved and most shocking offenders and events that you probably have ever heard of.
That's right. Only the most evil are covered here.
So join us once a week
as we serve up some evil pudding.
I don't know about you guys, but I'm ready to devour some evil pudding.
Oh, God. I love their name.
It's an awesome name.
Yeah.
Yeah. So everybody just check them out on Instagram and download their episodes. They sound like it's a very knowledgeable podcast.
It's one that I want to dive into. I'm going to download all of their episodes.
Yeah, me too.
And now, back to our weekly episode.
Hello, everyone, and welcome again to World's True Crime. I'm Brad, and with me, as always, is my beautiful fiancée, Denise.
Hello, everyone.
So this time, on our trip around the world, we're going to be going to China. And we're just going to put a disclaimer out there. This one's going to be a very tough one, because the names and the places are very hard to pronounce. So I just want you guys to bear with us.
Yeah, I apologize now.
Yeah, just because it's tough, though, we're not going to shy away from it. We want to tackle these ones the best we can.
Oh, definitely.
So yeah, we are definitely going to apologize to anyone we may offend by mispronouncing names and or places. So we're just going to let you know who we're going to be talking about today. It's going to be a guy by the name of Long Zhimin. He was a Chinese serial killer, and together with his wife, Yan Shuxia, he murdered 48 people in his home, and he buried them all in his courtyard and under the dirt floor of his home, just like John Wayne Gacy.
Oh, really?
Yeah, he did.
See, I want to learn about that case.
Yeah, he had like 33 young boys under his home or somewhere around there.
Oh, my God.
Yeah, so they lived in a place called Shaanxi between 1983 and 85. This is when this all took place. So this criminal case shocked Zhihongnanhai and the Chinese State Council. Is now referred to as Long Zhimin Couples Homicides. And with that intro, I want to send it off to Denise so she could tell you about the story.
I think you're doing so well that maybe you should just continue on with this.
No, I'm good.
Long Zhimin was a farmer, originally from Shang County, which is known as Xianzhou District, Shang Luo. His mother died of illness when he was just 6 years old, and his sister was only three. With the lack of his mother's care and education since he was a child, coupled with the ideology of preferring sons to daughters and passing on the generations, his father spoiled him and pampered him.
And that's a long tradition of the Chinese. They cherish their sons more than their daughters.
Which is very sad.
It is, yeah, 100%. It should be the same everywhere around, but the boys have a much higher, how do you say, like, love over there?
I guess because they pass on their genes, but you know what? They can't pass them on without the female.
I'm not going to get into that.
Okay. So when he was a child, Zhimin loved to learn, but he wasn't very good at it, so he gave up. He was the oldest of his classmates, but also the shortest. And as an adult, he was less than 150 centimeters tall, or 4'9", and was often ridiculed and bullied for his height. After entering society, Zhimin was notoriously lazy and even pretended to be sick, just trying to get out of working. In those years, the production team in rural areas kept working points, divided rations, and concentrated farming. Jimin pretended to be sick every time he went to work, and sometimes he refused to work in the fields. During the Cultural Revolution, he mustered up the energy to set up the Red Guard organization.
What is the Red Guard organization?
So what I found about the Red Guards is that it was a mass student-led paramilitary social movement that was mobilized and guided by Chairman Mao Zedong in 1966 through 1967. Jimin would often raid homes and criticize cadres, which gradually revealed the inadequacy in him. Although the organization had disintegrated, the seeds of evil in his heart had already begun to take root. In the spring of 1974, due to the construction of the Nansing Reservoir, he moved to Wonki Village, Yangya'a Township. But the way they sound, it sounds so much nicer than the way we say it.
Yeah, we say it probably very rude-like.
They say it almost like it's an elegant language.
Yeah. And I'm not elegant with his language.
I'm not elegant at all with anything.
These are hard words to pronounce, I'm not going to lie.
Thank you. Thank you for this case.
Oh, you're welcome. I knew it was going to be a little tough, but yeah, this is kind of a nightmare, I think. But, I mean, we're going to get through it.
Yeah, at this point, I'm wishing that people would send in recommendations. Reviews. No, recommendations for other episodes, so you don't have to pick them. Maybe they're going to be nicer than you are. Just saying.
Please.
Anyways, where was I? In 1977, Jimin once attacked a woman with dementia who was confined at home. He raped her until the village militia heard, and thankfully, the woman was saved. It is rational to say that such a heinous crime should have been severely punished, but in that era, when the legal system collapsed, he not only got away with it and not punished, he was also regarded by villagers as holding back for too long.
So you're saying that he needed to get a little relief and they're okay with it?
Yeah, he just needed to relieve his downstairs and they were okay with that.
Okay.
Yeah. So in order to cure his needs, the townspeople introduced him to Yan Shuxia in 1979.
And that was his wife.
Yeah, they ended up getting married. Yan Shuxia, she was a disabled woman who contracted meningitis as a child, which left her lower limbs paralyzed. Jimin and his wife did end up having a daughter, but she was brought up by her grandmother. And after the case broke out, their daughter had to change her name numerous times and ran away. Eventually, she did get married and moved far away to Xinjiang. As an adult, Jimin was still extremely lazy, and his family was impoverished because of it. At that time, the production team stipulated that each laborer had to complete 400 basic skills a year. But Jimin only completed dozens of them in the coming year, and he would receive very little grain. Sometimes he was dissatisfied, so he secretly went to the production team to make corrections and alter the points for himself.
So he's a cheater and a lazy cheater.
Oh, he's so much more than that. That's just the beginning.
Oh, really?
Yeah. He was so lazy that when the production team divided the grain and rice, he was too lazy to carry it home, so the production team would deliver it to his door. In 1982, the implementation of household contract responsibility system in rural areas across the country had begun.
What does that mean?
It basically means that households were held responsible for their profits and losses of their land. In short, it gave them relative freedom over the land decisions and crop selection. During the contract period, the farmers would pay taxes to the state and collective reserves to local governments and keep all of the produce for themselves. This was great for China as it helped lower the starvation rate since production went up. As for Jimin, he decided it was time to embark on large-scale crimes, so he devised a plan. Between March 1983 and May 1985, Jimin, with the help of his wife, coerced 48 people, 31 men and 17 women into his home with promises of introducing them to upper-class people and high-paying employers by simply offering free accommodation. In March 1983, Zhimin committed his first crime. When the victims entered his house, they would be killed while sleeping and subsequently buried on the property. The first night, when the man fell asleep, his wife, Shuxia, helped with the lighting while Zhimin brutally bludgeoned the man, then stabbed him until he lost his breath and he was winded. After the couple killed the man, they stripped off his clothes in search of his belongings for valuables. They even cut off his hair and hid it under the bed.
Do you know why they cut off the hair and hid it under the bed?
I don't. It didn't say. I looked around everywhere. I'm just thinking that maybe to be softer or something. Softer bed.
Like a padding? Softer bed that they're sleeping on?
Yeah. That's all I can think of because some people slept on grass, right?
I guess so. Yeah, this is the 80s in China. Yeah, I don't know what they slept under.
Neither do I.
Yeah.
I'm just thinking that maybe it was...
It just seems weird to me.
Yeah, same here, because I don't think there's any profit in it.
Probably not. I have no idea why they do that.
Wigs or anything, right?
No, like, I don't know. It's one of those things where we don't have the information for.
No, I looked it up and I couldn't find anything. I'm just thinking, maybe a softer bed.
Yeah, most likely. We'll go with that.
They need a good night's sleep after bludgeoning, you know, someone to death.
Yeah. So, hold on. It was under their bed?
Yeah.
Oh, I mean, it definitely could be for, like, a lot of serial killers like to take things from their victims. It could just be taking their hair just to have with them at all times.
Because, yeah, with all the victims, they took their hair and put them in their bed, like, under the bed.
Yeah, it could definitely be for sentimental value, maybe.
Sentimental value.
Seriously. Some serial killers take rings and jewelry and stuff like that so they know, it reminds them of that kill. These people could take the hair, they could take it out to remind them of that kill.
That's just disgusting. It's so disturbing.
Yeah. But you never know. Whatever it is, that's for them to know and us to try to figure out and speculate, right?
Yeah, for sure. So waiting until late at night when people were quiet, Zhimin dug a pit in their courtyard or in their home and buried them. Because he did bury them in the courtyard as well as in their home. And so this was a technique that they used in all of their victims. For 2 years, he would kill people, and no one was the wiser. That was, thankfully, until he made a huge mistake and took people that would be missed.
Okay, so at first, for the first 2 years, he was taking people, like, people that...
Unknowns.
Unknowns who wouldn't be missed, maybe vagrants, stuff like that.
Mm-hmm, exactly.
Okay, and then all of a sudden, usually what happens, they usually take somebody that some people look deeper into, and then that's when they usually get caught.
That's what happened here. So, on January 11th, 1985...
And you know what happens at this time.
Movie time!
Yep.
Because, yeah. We couldn't get into the kills before because we weren't sure when they actually happened.
Yeah, this is when they first...
This is when...
was known, I guess.
Yes, exactly.
Because nobody knows when the first kill was.
They just know the years.
Yeah, so... I mean, I like to do this stuff as the first kills, so know what's going on, but we can't do it in this case. We're just going to go here.
Okay.
All right. Okay, this is so freaking easy, though. Like, there's not many 80s movies that are really big, but this was on the box office for months.
That doesn't tell me nothing. Look, I know nothing about true crime. I know nothing about movies. I only know music from the 80s.
Okay.
Not movies.
The easiest way to put this, if I give anything in the movie, you're going to get it immediately.
So I'll give you until I don't, and everyone's laughing while they're listening
I'll give you a hint of the person who's in the movie, and then you can guess the movie.
Okay.
Okay. The person who's in the movie, he does a stand-up comedy bit. Lots of them, actually, but we really, really love...
Like Delirious?
Yes, it is. It's actually Delirious. I was about to say his red jumpsuit.
Oh, is that the movie?
Yeah.
Oh.
No, it's not the movie, though, but that's the person in the movie.
Oh, okay.
So what was his biggest movie in the 80s?
Biggest movie in the 80s.
Of his.
He's got so many movies.
What was his biggest series? Like, there was, like, two or three of them? I think there's two.
Flubber is after.
Whoa, you're, like, mid-90s right there.
I know. I'm just thinking. I'm thinking out loud. What about, was he in the animal ones? No.
What? Where are you?
I don't know. I mean, in a room.
Okay. His name in the movie was Axel Foley. Now, if you don't get this, come on.
I'm not going to get this. I know the name, Axel Foley. But I can watch a movie and we'll say, okay, the next day happens. What was that movie called? I won't know. But it was a phenomenal movie.
Okay. I'll give you another hint in it. It has...
What about that movie with the money?
What?
He was in a movie with money.
Okay, here's another hint. Okay. It has Judge Reinhold in it as well. Judge Reinhold was the guy from...
I know who he is.
You do? Okay.
Yeah.
He plays a cop?
Yeah. I know the movie now. I can see it. I just can't think of the name of it. I can't think of the name of it.
Okay, I'm going to play you the music of it. I hope I'm not going to get banned for this. One sec.
I know the movies. I can't think of the name.
Okay, there is the theme board. Now, can you guess that movie?
I am a complete dunce. Beverly Hills Cop. Yeah?
I can't believe that. We did like 4 minutes on this.
I know. I am sorry to everyone.
So all the people that was yelling right now for her to figure out that movie, I'm pretty sure 99% of the people got that instantly.
I'm sure 100% got that. Come on, let's get real.
Wow, I thought that was a softball. I was afraid to give you any hints because you get so fast.
That's how you know it's real, because I just didn't know. Oh my gosh.
I do not tell her these. It's complete legit. Like, I actually look it up right before we start recording, and she did not look at any of it.
Sometimes I'm tempted to do it, like, just to throw you off. I know it, but I don't want to cheat like that.
Oh, I know. That was good. That was a good
one.
My
cheeks hurt. My cheeks hurt. And I could feel they're red. I'm blushing because I'm such an idiot.
Okay, so all the people that were yelling, you all got it.
Beverly Hills Cop.
Everybody except for Denise got it.
Yeah, 1 point for everyone, 0 for Denise. I'm not on a pedestal. I don't think I'm awesome. I don't think I'm perfect. I am just me.
Okay, well, there you go. Let's move on.
So embarrassing. Okay, so anyways, on January 11th, I can't stop smiling. On January 11th, 1985, one of the missing, I gotta get serious here, John Sanha, the deputy party secretary of the village, and others returned to Shaanxi County after working in Xi'an. After getting off the Xitu bus station, some people encountered Zhimin, who was recruiting people to work for him. He said he would pay 5 yuan a day for someone to dig a pigsty for his home.
How much is that, do you know?
I know what the amount is in today's terms, but not in 1983. In today's money, it's 97 cents.
Holy, that's cheap. And back then, it's probably like down to like 40-something cents.
I would think so.
Maybe 50? I don't know. Yeah, it's pretty bad.
At the time, 5 yuan a day was considered not a small amount, but there were several people that did not agree. I guess it's like you have 20 bucks in your pocket right now. You might think it's only 20 bucks, or you might think, wow, I've got 20 bucks. And somebody else might think otherwise, right?
I wish I had 20 bucks in my pocket right now.
Give me all your money.
I haven't seen money in years. Y'all know where it all goes to.
Yeah, I have a heavy purse. Thank you. So Sanha was, however, tempted to get that 5 yuan a day and follow Zhimin back to his home. Unfortunately for Sanha, he was never seen alive again. He just disappeared. His younger brother, Zhang Yi Xian, who works at S. Henry Oil Field, spoke to the police about his brother's disappearance many times, but nothing was done about it.
This reminds me of that one other case we did there when all the kids were going missing, all the parents came forward, and the police did nothing about that one either.
Oh, yeah, yeah, Noda.
Yeah, Noda or Ramadan, right?
Ramadan, he threw people from the train.
Yeah, so it must have been Noda then, yeah.
Yeah. all those kids went missing and they kept going to the police.
And that's nothing, right. Yeah. All the parents went to the police and nobody did anything about it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It does.
I guess it happens a lot.
Yeah. Unfortunately. I don't think it would happen nowadays.
No, it's a lot different now.
Yeah. Not wanting to let his brother's disappearance go, he decided to take an extended holiday and use that time to search all over Shaanxian County, which ended up lasting a few months. Yi Xian's family also found some clues. They found that there was a man named Long Zhimin, who often appeared at the Xitu bus station in the county and often recruited workers to do odd jobs.
So that's where his downfall is. These people are looking for their brother and they came to him, I guess, right?
They kind of figure things out, yeah. Because he was always going there and that's the last place that his brother was seen.
Yeah, yeah, that's...
He should have switched up his game plan of killing people instead of always going to this bus station.
Well, that's an MO, right?
Yeah, I guess so, yeah.
That's what people do. They do their MO, and that's what most people get caught, because they do the same thing over and over again.
Mm-hmm. So because he was always going there, they were curious about everything, and they knew that something was wrong with Zhimin. Because why would he constantly go there?
Yeah, exactly.
Meanwhile, another person went missing, D.U. Chang Ying. On May 16th, 1985, Chang Ying, a 40-year-old villager in Y.E. Miao, L.I.U. Wan Township, woke up early and went to the market in Shaanxian County. It's now known as Xianzhou District, Shang Liu City.
Okay.
That's a hard one.
Those are hard ones. That's a lot going on there. Holy.
I feel like I just mentioned off, 10 different places right there.
So it's now known as Xianzhou District, Shang Liu City, Shaanxi, which, that's a place I've never heard of, obviously.
Obviously, no. And obviously you should be doing this one because you just riddled that off so fast.
Well, I'm okay sometimes.
That was actually really good, babe.
Thank you.
So Chang Ying asked his brother to go back home first, since he also wanted to see if there was any odd work in the city that he could do to earn some money before he went home. Odd jobs were very common. There were a large number of rural laborers who were idle, and everyone went to the city to find job opportunities in order to make a living. At that time, there were no telephones, and people who found jobs were not able to notify their families for some time. Usually, families never knew about their work until the job was complete. So it was normal not to hear from your families for long periods of time.
And that also reminds me of the other case we did there. And the same one, Noda, when he would always work all the time. Surinder Kohli would take off from his wife for a long period of the time. Same thing.
Yeah, he would take off for work. He'd only go back home like once a month.
Yeah, this must be very common over in those areas. It's not over here very often. Like, we have like the trucking jobs and we work in mines and stuff, but it's not, extended amount of time.
Insert your job, insert my old job.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I don't know what it's like nowadays there. I'm kind of curious.
Yeah, for sure.
After the elder brother came home from the market, he found that his younger brother, Chang Ying, was missing and had not come back for several days. When Chang Ying disappeared, the Public Security Department of the remote Northwest County had received a report of 37 missing persons between 1983 to 1985. Surprisingly, the missing persons were mostly male farmers who went out to work, and a lot did not have fixed places to stay or jobs. Some of them that did go missing had only gone to the city to buy necessities. The security organs, aka the police, had never had the slightest clue as to where these people went missing or disappeared to. And there was no evidence of foul play either, so they were just listed as missing persons and not murdered.
So I don't want to just brush over this, but the security organs? That's what they called the police?
Organs. It's probably short for organization.
Okay, the security organization. Okay, because you said this, the security organs. I was like, are we just going to brush past this?
Everywhere I looked, it said organs, though.
Okay.
So yeah. I've actually Googled it because I thought that was weird, too.
Okay, I just want to make sure we didn't pass that without...
It says security organs.
Okay.
Maybe it's short for organizations, or maybe it's just organs.
Okay. I just wanted to
clear that up a little bit. It's just body parts,
man. Okay.
Can you feel good now?
Yeah, I feel better.
Okay. Thankfully, the answers to so many questions would be revealed by the disappearance of Chang Ying. At one point, Chang Yan began to think that his brother might have gone to a friend's house or another place, but the thought did not sit well with him. He didn't think his brother would just disappear. He felt like it was far more serious than that. He had an ominous feeling inside him that his brother was in trouble. Chang Yan said that under normal circumstances, it was impossible for his brother to not go home for long periods of time, since he had more than a dozen pigs in his own family. He would not just leave them unattended for a job. Unwilling to let the whereabouts of his brother go, Chang Yan started his own search, trying to find clues to his brother's whereabouts. Luckily, a clue did come up. One he was looking for, the case of the inconspicuous IOU 1 week later. On May 25th, a villager named Long Zhimin went to a financial office at the paper mill to withdraw money for the IOU. The person that was handling the transaction was Hu Yi Singh. The IOU happened to be signed by D.U. Chang Ying and only the value of $1.85.
Is that like our money right now?
That's their money.
Okay, so in our market, you know what that is?
21 cents.
Okay, I guess you do know.
21
That's
cents.
That's not much.
No. Like, he went to the bank to cash in an IOU for 21 cents.
That's unheard of. That's crazy.
Yeah. Desperate times, man.
Yeah.
So although that wasn't much money, Yi Singh felt unsure and even strange. So he asked Zhimin, "How did you get my cousin's note into your hands?" Zhimin did not expect the cashier that he would end up dealing with would be Chang Ying's cousin.
That's just a weird twist of fate right there.
It was a good thing. He was obviously startled when he heard the question, and he sputtered an answer. He said that his cousin, Chang Ying, owed him money and failed to pay. So when he saw him on the streets, he stopped him and asked for his payment. Because he had no money on him, he decided to pay with an IOU.
I wish we could still use those IOUs nowadays. That always reminds me of Dumb and Dumber. That's for a Ferrari. You want to keep that one?
Yeah. I'm just going to go Walmart and pay with IOU. Catch you later.
Yeah.
Oh, man. So, Yiding, the cousin, did not take his words lightly and even became suspicious of Jameen's answer. Yi Singh, I love that name actually. Yi Singh knew that his family's cousin was pretty well off and he would not owe him money. In the end, he didn't give the money for the IOU to
Jameen.
And Jameen left very disappointed.
Yeah, you gotta get that 21 cents.
Yep. It's now been 10 days. Since his brother Chang Ying's disappearance. When Chang Yan went looking for his brother in the county, he stopped by to visit his cousin, Yi Singh, at the financial paper mill. The two exchanged greetings, and Chang Yan brought up his brother's disappearance. After hearing the story, Yi Singh was taken aback and then shouted, "2 days ago, Long Zhimin from Yangyue Township took a slip of RMB 1 and 8 cents to collect the money. But it said D.U. Chang Ying's name." After relaying the visit that Zhimin had with him, they both felt that there was something more going on to the story. The next day, on the 28th, he and his cousin, Yi Singh, found Zhimin. They told him that Chang Ying had not returned home for 10 days and had hopes that Zhimin might be able to help. They asked him to go to the police station with them to make things clear, and Zhimin was supposed to follow them to set things straight. But more so, Zhimin wanted to go there to start a ruckus with Chang Yan to quickly repay him for the money that his brother owed. Coincidentally, San Han's family had heard about Zhimin and went to the police station. When they went inside, they saw a group who were already talking to Jimin, so they rushed towards them and said, "Don't let him escape." At first, the police felt that this short, bald-headed, barefoot farmer in front of him could not be a criminal, and even considered letting him go. But to be cautious, they took Jimin into custody for questioning. Jimin was a very cunning man. Faced with the interrogation by the police, he made all kinds of excuses. Regarding Chang Ying's note, he insisted that Chang Ying owed him 20 yuan and took his note as a partial payment. As for where he went, he did not know. When questioned about Zhang Sanha, he did admit that he used him for work on a pigsty, but he finished the job in one afternoon. He said Sanha stayed at the house for one night and left in the morning. Again, just like Chang Ying, he said he didn't know where he went.
So a lot of people are going missing, and they're blaming him, and he's just like, yeah, I have no idea.
Yeah, I don't know.
I don't know.
Their interrogation went until 4 a.m., and because of the way he answered his questions, they decided it was best to keep him in custody and check out his home in the morning. On May 29th, 1985, two policemen came to Jimin's house early in the morning to check to see if there was anything strange going on. Upon getting to the home, they quickly discovered that Jimin's wife, Shaanxi, had suffered meningitis as a child and was now paralyzed on her lower limbs, and she behaved strangely and incoherent. To top it off, the home smelt abnormally putrid. The officers felt extremely uncomfortable walking in. The windows were blacked off with adobe, and the interior was dark. The floor of the house was also bumpy and full of potholes, as if it was recently dug up. Upon careful observation, there seemed to be traces of it shoveled.
So the home was a pigsty, like, without any pigs present.
Yeah, the home was literally a pigsty.
And also, too, I want to point out there, like, they're like right in the living room, and there's they're digging up, like, right in the living room.
Yeah, they were digging bodies just below their feet in their home because they had no solid ground on their home.
It was just dirt floor. That's extremely weird.
And they were digging these graves right below where they lived.
Yeah, like, there's, oh, let's just go make dinner under these, like, 10 bodies underneath the kitchen floor.
Can you move that chair out of the way so I can dig a hole for this body?
Oh, yeah, that's And then we can
sit down and have our meal.
Yeah, weird.
Mm-hmm. To top it off, there was things everywhere. It was a literal pigsty plus a messy house.
So like a hoarder house type deal.
Exactly. There was so much garbage and stuff that you couldn't even stand with your feet. And the air was even disgusting and felt filthy. And there was dust and spiderwebs all over the place. It seems like the extreme hoarder. You know that TV show?
Yeah.
There also seemed to be dark spots on the ladder, like dark purple spots on the ladder, heading to the attic. Based on the experience, the police suspected that they were bloodstains. When they questioned Shuxia, she said, "Nothing in the house. A few people came to the house. I heard movement outside at night. The next day, they disappeared. I washed the clothes and the water is red." When the police asked her what was going on, she shut up. Her words made the police extremely suspicious. At this point, the police felt that there was something large going on.
Yeah, she seems like she's hiding something.
Mm-hmm. Oh, she was, wasn't she?
Yeah.
And they figured it out quite quickly. They decided it was time to go back to the police station to report to the superiors and request reinforcements. Once receiving the report from the police who went to Jimin's home, the Public Security Bureau felt that the situation was serious enough to investigate further, and immediately dispatched Wang Kuo-Cheng, an experienced criminal policeman, to lead the investigation at Jimin's home. In addition to the police, the village security director and other related personnel also came to Jimin's home.
So they had like all hands on deck for this one.
Absolutely. Everyone was there. Before the search began, the security director told the public security officer that Jimin's house was stinking all day, and no other villager came to his house. In fact, as soon as Kuo-Cheng arrived with his excellent professional quality and rich expert in exploration, Kuo-Cheng smelled a different scent from the general pungent odor. That was the smell of a disturbed corpse.
That's a smell I do not want to smell.
I actually Googled what it smells like, and it's kind of a rank smell with a sweetness.
Probably almost the same as like when you hunt, like when you open up a moose or a deer or something like that.
Yeah, I remember the smell of blood when I used to go hunting with people. And that smell, I still remember it, that warm blood smell. And it's so disgusting.
Yeah, it's like the mercury smell, right?
Yeah, it's so gross.
Yeah, I'm not a hunter, so I have no idea. It's all new. I've never smelled it before, and I don't really want to.
Well, I didn't actually hunt. I was just there, and I was helping them gut. And I was trying not to vomit because it was so bad. So Kuo Chang knew that there was definitely something wrong in that house. Kuo Chang began his search according to his smell and soon aimed his sights on the radish cellar next to the east wing of Jimin's house. He said, "The smell came from here." Turning over the pile of scattered wheatgrass next to it, two naked male corpses hugging each other appeared in front of the people. This scene made everyone take a deep breath.
Yeah, that's something that you do not want to see when you're searching.
No, I just can't imagine that. After identification, one of the deceased was sadly Du Yu Cheng Ying.
That was the guy's brother, the guy who's looking for him, right?
Yes, yeah. It was. The other deceased was not Zhang Sei Ah, the other brother that was being looked for.
Yep.
Okay.
These names are a little bit tough to keep track of.
It is. I'm sorry.
That's okay. I know the Du Cheng Ying. That's the one I really know because his brother was really looking for him, yeah. Like really hard.
And same with this one. His brother went on vacation. He worked at the oil field.
That's right, yeah.
And he took the extended vacation looking for his brother.
Yeah, he was there for a while, wasn't he?
Mm-hmm. For a couple of months he was looking. And then he went to the police station and seen the Cheng Ying's brother talking to Jimin.
Jimin, yeah.
Yeah.
So do they know who this other man was right now?
The other person was not even a man. He was just a 16 or 17-year-old boy.
Oh, wow.
Mm-hmm. Due to the time of death and the hot weather, the two bodies had already begun to decompose, emitting a stench that made people vomit. I'd be with them.
Yep.
Swallowing down the vomit in their throats and enduring the stench, the police conducted a preliminary examination on the cause of death of the two corpses. It was determined that the cause of death was by a blunt blow to the head.
Like blunt force trauma to the head, right?
Yep.
Yeah.
Cheng Ying was done in the most tragic way, and his head was almost smashed till there was nothing left. The police continued to search, and soon found a bulging fertilizer bag behind the firewood. When they opened up the bag, it turned out to be a naked corpse of a 50-year-old woman.
So, yeah, they're all over the place then. They have young boys, middle-aged men, and then old women.
Mm-hmm. They were scattered all over.
If you count 50-year-old woman old, but middle-aged woman.
I would say she's not old.
Yeah, middle-aged. Just go with that one.
I kind of want to just smack you for that one.
I don't want people to be smacking me, writing me bad messages.
Yeah.
Middle-aged woman, sorry.
She's not even middle-aged. Not nowadays anymore.
No, exactly.
So, judging from the situation of the female corpse, there was no odor, and the time of death did not exceed 3 days.
That's a short period of time there.
It seemed like he was murdering the people and sometimes not burying them right away. So, these last ones
were still out of the ground, yeah.
Yeah, he hadn't had time to bury them yet.
So, now that's three bodies now discovered, right?
Mm-hmm. Exactly. You're on the ball. I threw the ball and you caught it. Although Sanha has not been found yet, news of the three bodies found in Jimin's home spread like wildfire. Soon, the doorway of the house was surrounded by villagers. This investigation was now upgraded to a major criminal case. Kuo Chang didn't delay. While arranging personnel to guard the scene, he immediately rushed back to the bureau to report the case to the higher-ups. The case was extremely serious, and the situation was urgent. The main leaders of the political and legal departments of Shaanxia County were now on the scene. Soon, a large number of armed police also came and blocked the intersection of the village to prevent Jimin's possible accomplices, if any he had, from fleeing. All cadres or activists and militiamen at the location of the case were mobilized. With so many people dead, it was normal to suspect Zhimin may have many accomplices in the village. It was necessary to take all precautions in advance, especially when you're dealing with thousands of people. Zhimin, who was still detained at the Public Security Bureau, was now put in shackles and interrogated once again. Although he knew he could not escape death, he took it lightly and only explained how he killed these three people that they have found. His method was very simple. First, he tricked people into doing some work by recruiting small workers. Then these people were resting at night. His disabled wife would seduce them. He took advantage of that. They were preoccupied and wouldn't be expecting anything. At this point, he would hit the victims on the head with a hammer from behind, causing their death. Due to the number of missing people, Zhimin only admitted to killing the three people. They questioned him about more. Since the amount of missing people was so high, they asked him if he knew about their whereabouts and if he had killed them. Meanwhile, at Jameen's home, they started to use police dogs in their help to search for more bodies. Unfortunately, nothing new was found. The director of the village security remembered that Zhimin had asked people to dig a cellar for storing radishes many times before, but the cellar was no longer used. Instead, there are cabbages planted in it. Immediately, they wondered if there might be bodies buried in it. The chief security officer decided the area needed to be looked at. At around 11:30 a.m., the situation that everyone didn't want happened. When a policeman inserted a detection gun into the ground just meters away from the east side of the cellar, his hands and expression changed, and his body froze. He felt the detection gun stop, and it seemed to be stuck in a hole. The village's militiamen quickly cleaned up a 3-meter by 2-meter area in the cabbage field and dug deep.
So I'm guessing that the smell of the rotting remains was camouflaged by the strong scent of the cabbage to that the head of the floor there.
Yeah, I think that you're correct in that because it's got such a strong smell, right?
Yeah, cabbage has a strong smell.
Yeah, so I think that you're right. What they found made people horrified. There are 9 corpses neatly placed in a cellar.
So this 3 turned to not like 12 now real quickly, mm-hmm. right? Wow, that's intense.
But just wait. Their heads and feet were neatly placed, staggered upside down, like head to toe kind of thing.
Yeah,
like firewood.
Yep.
And just when they thought they saw it all, they found another 8 corpses under those ones as well.
So that's 20 now, isn't it?
It is.
Holy.
You were so good with math.
20. That's from 3 to 20. That's extreme.
And amount. He denied. He said, nope, just the 3.
It's funny too, because John Wayne Gacy, in his basement, he actually had maps of where his corpses were. Like, he actually had a map of it underneath his place, and he put where the corpses were. I wonder if he did something like this.
I was thinking about that case earlier today, and I thought, if anybody knows of a really good podcast to listen to that, because I know nothing about it, to send us an email and let me know, because I want to look that one up and listen to a really good podcast on it with as much detail as possible. So if you know someone...
worldstruecrime@hotmail.com.
Yeah, if you know the... Yeah, good little plug there.
Yeah.
Send it to me. I want to know all about it. Since everyone else does and I'm just in this under this rock, you know. Anyways, we're at 20 bodies right now. And at this point, the excavation had to be put on hold because it was so late at night. And as we said before, the place was so dimly lit because it was adobe windowed.
Yeah, and also too, yeah, they're also on the walking around the crime scene pretty much because they're all buried underneath the floor all over the house. So they got to be mm-hmm. careful where they're walking now and, you know, not to disturb the crime scene either.
Yep, exactly it.
Because everywhere now is a crime scene because you don't know where a body's placed.
Nope. And now that they found all these other bodies, like throughout that day, 20 bodies, now Jameen's wife is under arrest as well.
Well, I guess she has to know about it for sure.
Oh, yeah. I only know nothing. I know nothing. Washing the clothes and it turned red. That's kind of strange that she said that.
Yeah.
So the search didn't continue until the next day at dawn. and the excavation of the cellar started up once again. The body count now, 33.
Wow. That's
just a lot.
From the cellar, right?
Just from the cellar alone. However, that's not all. After a short rest, the police found a large pit in the actual pigsty, which contained 8 neatly stacked bodies. And next to that large pit, there was a smaller pit that had 4 bodies in it.
So that's another 12 bodies on top of this.
Yeah, we're at the total body count now.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
I don't even know how to have the count in my head anymore.
We're at 48. Among them, Yan, B.A.I. Singh, and his wife were killed along with their 2-year-old child.
They killed a 2-year-old child too on top of this?
Yep.
Wow. That's sad. Holy.
Mm-hmm. The authorities thought there must be accomplices. However, it was later revealed that almost all of it was done by Zhimin alone, and the only accomplice was his wife, Shuxia. They were hopeful that more bodies would turn up, since this would bring so much closure to so many.
Yeah, all the missing people that goes there, it'll close a lot of cases the more bodies they find.
Exactly. And even if my loved one had passed away, I would want to know.
Exactly. Because you don't want to be waiting on limbo not knowing.
Exactly. When the police asked Zhimin if he still had any more people hidden, Zhimin answered very concisely, "I don't kill people for their money. I kill for their country. I have 3 things I don't kill. I don't kill science and technology personnel. I don't kill state officials. And I don't kill employees or workers. I only kill those handicapped, ignorant, silly, or silly people." Whew, that's a lot,
yeah.
No matter how grandiose of an excuse Zhimin gave, he couldn't offset the fact of his heinous crimes. In fact, except for a few people who had certain physical and intellectual disabilities, the people he killed were all healthy adults. Most of them were strong laborers in the country and were the backbone of their family.
Yeah, because I remember early on that he said that they killed farmers and workers. Mm-hmm. Like, he's not killing the handicapped and stuff. He's killing hardworking people looking to make money for their families.
He was just trying to make an excuse for the...
Oh, 100%. Yeah.
Yeah, just trying to make an excuse for his wrongdoings.
Yep.
His murder. In the beginning, Jameen's motives went from free labor to robbing for money and then filling his need for sex. But after killing people again and again, it seemed that the killings became more of an addiction. An expert once asked him, "Aren't you afraid to live with corpses?" Zhimin replied, "At first, I was afraid. The sound of the blood dripping on the floor of the corpse would scare me. Thinking about it, why was I afraid of them when I killed everyone? There is no ghost in the world, so you don't have to scare yourself. Killing people is the same as killing chickens or slaughtering cows or even simpler."
Wow, he definitely is, killing for him is easy.
Mm-hmm. It was never going to stop.
No.
On August 30th, 1985, Zhimin and his wife were both prosecuted for intentional homicide. When questioned, it was discovered that in total, Zhimin and his wife made a mere 573 yuan. Within the 573 yuan, it included 15 passbooks, $3.13 of yuan in cash, 91.5 caddies of food stamps, and 4 watches. In addition to the small amount of money found, the police also found 1,011 pieces of various physical evidence at Jameen's house. The problem that still existed after Jameen's case broke out was that more than 60 people came forward with the disappearance of their loved ones. Although only 48 corpses were discovered, only 30 bodies were claimed. So 18 of those bodies that were found, no one knows.
No one came forward with them, right? No. Yeah.
On September 20th, Zhimin and his wife, Shuxia, were sentenced to death for the 48 murders of innocent lives. He did, however, apply for an appeal, but it was quickly dismissed, and the first verdict was upheld.
Yeah, so I know every time you get, convicted of murder, there's always an appeal. Like, there's even appeals, like we talked about earlier in some of the other episodes, that they even appealed before even got handed out. I think it was in Anders, that they actually appealed before the sentence even came out.
Mm-hmm.
Because they knew he was going to be guilty, so they already started the appeal process.
Right. I guess they have nothing to lose, right?
No, you don't. You appeal everything. You always appeal.
His excuse was absolutely absurd, though. Jameen's reasoning was shocking to everyone. He said that Huan Chao killed 8 million people, and yet he was not sentenced to death.
So, I don't really know much, but do you know who Huan Chao is?
I looked him up, and I found that Huan Chao was a Chinese smuggler, soldier, and rebel leader during the Tang Dynasty. He and his followers successfully looted through China in 875 until his death in 884 CE.
So he pretty much was a dictator pretty much back then. Yeah. A Chinese dictator.
Yeah, exactly. Who killed many people.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. I think I've slightly heard of him, but not so much.
Of course you have. You know a little bit of everything.
Yeah, I don't know much about it, though. I've heard the name. That's kind of about it. Like, maybe. Mm. Like, it just sounds familiar to me. I do know mostly about dictators, but not a lot of them, especially China ones, because all their information is hard to come by. Mm-hmm. So it's hard to find people like that. And so by telling him to go take it up with him, you're basically saying, take it up with him because he's dead and you're going to be dead soon?
Yep.
Okay.
I thought that was quite funny. So 7 days later, on September 27th, Long Jimin and his wife, Yan Shuxia, were both executed by shooting. And that does it for this case.
Yeah, there's not a lot of information about the victims, I guess, because I guess Chinese, they keep it more to themselves. We only know, like, the basic details of it.
Yeah. It's still quite a case, though.
Well, even 48 murders?
48 murders in his home.
Yeah, that's absurd.
He was walking, like, his home was a cemetery.
Oh, 100%. He was, like, the cellar, like, to get a body's, like, neatly stacked, like, head to toe. Like, that's a lot going on.
I'd be so creeped out.
Oh, me too. Like, how can you live in a place where you know that there's bodies everywhere?
I couldn't.
Oh, yeah. Like, I know some people, like, more, like, in our culture, like, even somebody who, like, passed away in a house is bad enough. People do not want to buy it because of just one little incident. But you have 48 bodies buried underneath your home.
That was one of the stipulations on getting this house, is if somebody died in it, I didn't want it.
No, exactly. And that's a lot of people. They don't want to. I mean, there's obviously some people out there who are like the morbid of it, but, you know. No.
Yeah, they think it's cool.
Yeah, exactly. But, I mean, that's not for me.
Not for me either. But apparently for Long Jimin and Shuxia, yep, that's for them.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Okay, so that's the case on Long Jimin and his wife.
Mm-hmm.
So what would you rate this 10. One?
Yeah. I'm not even going to let you stop.
I mean, the details are pretty gross. Like, they did a lot of bludgeoning and head trauma, stuff like that. So that's pretty up close and personal. It's not like you're shooting anybody.
He battered Chang Ying's head until he couldn't breathe anymore.
Oh, yeah. And then there's that one head that they couldn't tell anymore because it was beat up so bad.
That was Chang Ying.
Yeah. And, you know.
He just bludgeoned him till there was nothing left.
Yeah. And a 2-year-old baby. Like, there's so much going on here. And middle-aged people, like women too, like all over the place.
Yeah. In total, there were 31 men and 17 women.
Yeah, so it wasn't just, you know, working people. Like, there was everybody. Like, I thought it'd be more just males because they're more the worker type. But 17 women as well? That's a lot.
Yeah. It's sick.
Yeah. So, yeah, I'm going to put that as a 10 as well. Like, obviously, that's a pretty bad case.
Yeah. Come join me in the 10 club.
Yeah, that's... the details are a little lacking, but...
I did what I could.
We did what we could. Yeah. We said this earlier, too, that Chinese kind of keeps it all to themselves. Mm-hmm.
It was really hard with the names and places, too. Yeah. I struggled. If people could see if people could see my face.
Or all your personalities.
Yeah, they go with my many personalities. Shut up, Rebecca. I'm talking.
I couldn't let that one pass. That was too easy.
Oh, my gosh. Okay. I think it's time to stop this now.
Yeah, I think so, too.
Okay.
Okay, everybody, so you could find us over at worldstruecrime@hotmail.com. We want to hear from you guys. We don't hear from too many people. We want to hear more of you guys.
Or come over and see us on Instagram.
Yeah, even say hi to us. Just be like, hi.
Hi. We're always saying bye, so say hi.
Yeah, we're on Instagram. We're all pretty active on there right now. And yeah, it's a good place to meet a lot of people.
Oh, gosh, yes. Love it.
Yeah, and we also want to thank Denise's daughter, too, Sam, for the artwork. And she's going to be making us merch pretty soon.
Finally, she has time to do it.
Yes, that's awesome.
So we just have to give her some ideas of what we want, and she's going to draw them up.
Yeah, exactly. And the next case, we're going to be heading to Africa.
Ooh, Africa. Ooh, okay. That's scary.
Yeah, I think it's going to be a little bit easier on the names, but I mean, not the best.
Is it, though?
Yeah.
Is it?
Well, we'll see.
Be honest there, buddy.
We'll see.
Okay.
So, yeah, that's the next one.
It's going to be easier than China.
I think so. I think a lot are going to be easier than China.
Okay.
Okay, so that's going to do it for us, everybody. And we also want to say another shout out to the Evil Pudding Podcast. Thank you so much, guys.
Yeah, you guys are awesome.
All right, and that's the end of our show. So just remember, everybody, the world's not always as it seems.
No, it's not.
Bye, everyone.
Bye.